church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From him he came and saw.
Not long after I arrived here, a couple of years ago, we started a Wednesday night study on the Old Testament minor prophets. And a part of what we were doing is that we were taking a look at various prophets, but then we were kind of balancing them back and forth between Old Testament prophets and some of the shorter New Testament books. And you know how things go. You kind of go back and forth and back and forth, and then somehow or the other we got off into Revelation. And things just kind of disappeared after that. So I thought what we might do for the next several Sunday evenings is take a look at these Old Testament prophets that we have not yet studied. And we're going to be beginning all of that with the book of Obadiah. So you may want to take a little time to find Obadiah. He's a one chapter wonder, and so it's going to be a little bit difficult to find. Just FYI, he comes right after Amos, and so that's a larger minor prophet that you might be able to find more easily. But there's a lot to learn here. You know, the scripture tells us that the Old Testament is not just for Jewish folks. The Old Testament is for us. It's for Christians. There are things that we can learn here that are important. And so although these are called minor prophets, it really is crucial to understand that they're not minor in terms of we can kind of, you know, dismiss them and they're not really all that important. Because they really are. They have things to teach us and things that we really ought to know. And Obadiah especially seems to kind of deal with an issue that, well, we don't talk about all that often. Basically, he's going to be talking about holding grudges. So I thought that we might study the book of Obadiah starting this evening. Now, the name Obadiah basically means a worshiper of Yahweh. That's what his name means, and certainly his life and his prophecy reflect that name. But it was written probably one of two times, either during 840 BC or perhaps when Babylon was coming in and taking over Jerusalem. The likeliest hood is, however, that it was probably during the 840 BC invasion of the Arabs and the Philistines. They came into Jerusalem and they conquered Jerusalem and sort of looted it and pillaged it. But it is likely that time in which all this happened. This was during the reign of Jehoram. We can find it in 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verses 8 through 17. Just so happens that during this period of time also, the country of Edom, which is mostly what Obadiah is about, it's about Edom. Edom had rebelled against Judah. Judah had conquered, or at least made subservient, the country of Edom, and they had paid, shall we say, tribute to Judah. But during this invasion by the Philistines and the Arabs, Edom had rebelled. And because they rebelled, you know how that kind of a spirit can go. They kind of thought themselves to be able now to be able to gloat over what it was that had happened now to Judah. And all of this was happening, by the way, this rebellion of Edom, number one, but also the invasion of the Arabs and the Philistines because of Jehoram's wicked reign. He followed Jehoshaphat, who was a good guy, but it happened to be that Queen Jezebel was kind of like his grandmother. So he wasn't a very nice fellow, And because of all this wickedness, Judah was actually being punished. But the key theme of Obadiah basically boils down to this. It is the destruction of Edom. That is basically what is going on there. The situation is that Judah and Jerusalem, as I mentioned before, had been routed now by the Arabs and the Philistines. And although we oftentimes don't give a whole lot of thought to it, you know, we live in a peaceful country, right? We live in a country that really, I mean, okay, I know there's violence in the streets and all that sort of stuff too, but in terms of us actually being a country in the middle of a war, that hasn't happened to us since, what, the Civil War or something? We're not used to war going on in our country, and so we're not very familiar with what happens. But oftentimes in situations like that, because the country who has been invaded and looted and conquered now has no standing army, it's pretty much every man for himself. And if outsiders decide they want to come in and loot you, they can do that. If you happen to be on a farm in the middle of kind of nowhere, being a shepherd or a farmer or something along that line, and the Edomites or the Philistines or just marauding bands decide they want to come through and now, you know, take everything that you've got and maybe kill your entire family, well, they can do it now with impunity. No one's going to come to your aid anymore. And so that sort of thing actually did go on in that day, like it sometimes goes on in third world countries that happen to be at war even today. That's what was going on in the country of Judah. It was creating refugees from the conflict. And of course, refugees are always going to be vulnerable to attack. As you're trying to get away from the war and the battles that are going on, once again, it's not exactly like you would have, state troopers or something on the road somewhere. You're pretty much on your own. And if someone decided to attack you and rob you and do whatever else, well, they could. And once again, they could do it with absolute impunity. And Edom was doing that very thing. Apparently, they were taking advantage of the Philistines and the Arabs and the fact that they had conquered Jerusalem, and now there was no more barriers to them being able to loot and to pillage. Well, they were doing exactly that. But not only that, they appear, according to what we're reading here, to actually be gloating. Now, we don't use that word too often, but I think we all kind of know what it means. It's the sort of word that basically says, "Ha! Look at you! You're in terrible shape, and I am so glad." That's basically what gloating is. I'm glad that you're in a bad state of affairs. I'm glad that you're being oppressed. I'm glad that you're being punished. Hoo-hoo, I think I'll do a dance because of the fact that you're in such bad shape. That's what Edom was doing towards Judah. Now, you might wonder, why is it that Obadiah is actually spending so much time just kind of dressing down the Edomites? We don't see any reference here to the Arabs. We don't see any reference here to the Philistines. We don't find any reference to any of their other nations. Why? Why was it going on that way? Well, there is some background here that we need to know about. Here's why. Edom was the descendants of Esau. This goes back to the book of Genesis. Isaac and his wife, Rebekah, had two children, twins, Jacob and Esau. Jacob was actually, they were twins, but he was the second born. Esau was the firstborn. He's the one that had come out of the womb first. And consequently, he was the one who therefore, it was thought, would be designated as being the firstborn. He was going to be the one who was going to be having charge over the family after dad was gone. He was the one that was going to be the leader. He was going to be receiving all the blessings of the firstborn. That's what the thought was. But there was competition going on between Jacob and Esau even when they were in the womb. If you take a look at Genesis chapter 25, what you end up finding there is that when Rebekah becomes pregnant, she feels that there's two children inside of her. She feels that she's having twins, but apparently they're having a wrestling match in there or something, because she says, "What in the world is going on?" Already from the womb, they were in competition with each other, and apparently that competition never did stop. But the really serious rivalry happened some years later as Jacob began to usurp his brother's rightful place in the family as the firstborn. You might recall the story of Esau going out hunting. Now, for any of us who have gone out hunting before, we know that can be kind of an arduous task, right? You're out going over hill and dale and going all over the place and looking for something. And he apparently, Esau, had been doing this all day long. And he finally was coming in. We don't know what time of day it was, but it had to have been, you know, late in the day. And he was absolutely famished. He had gotten nothing. And here is his brother Jacob. His brother Jacob was a keeper of flocks. So he always had a little something to eat because he was there taking care of the flocks. So he comes across his brother Jacob and basically he says, "Oh, can I please have some of that red stew?" And you've heard me joke about the fact I really think it's chili. But anyway, besides all that, "Can I have some of that red stew?" And Jacob says, "Well, maybe. What do you got to offer for it?" "Oh, I don't know. I'll give you anything." "Well, how about your birthright?" "Oh, of course I'll trade my birthright," he says. "Because what does it matter? I'm going to die anyway." He was a little bit of an exaggerator, I suppose. I doubt very seriously he was that close to death. But he thought that he was, and so he was willing to trade away, and the Bible says despised his birthright. Of course, you know how things go. If once you've made a terrible deal like that, and you finally are full, and you're thinking, "Okay, I guess I'll live now," you start thinking about the deal that you made, and you kind of go, "Oh man, that Jacob, why didn't he just give me the stew? Why didn't he just help me out? Instead, he traded me, and I traded away one of the most valuable things I possibly could have, the firstborn status." But he kind of, you know, apparently swallowed that one, because after all, he did make the deal. But as time wore on, and Isaac began to get older, there was a tradition in the ancient world where when you were about to pass on as a father, you were going to pass on a blessing. And so Isaac called his son Esau in and said, "I'm getting old. I feel like my time is going to be near. And so I want to pass my blessing on to you. And here's what my plan is. I want you to go out, and I want you to go out hunting and bring in something. And I want you to spice it up the way you know I like it. And we'll have ourselves something of a fellowship meal. And during that fellowship meal, I will give my blessing to you." Now, part of what I didn't tell you, but is in the scripture nonetheless, is that Isaac was so old, his eyes were starting to fail him. He really couldn't see. But it happened to be that Rebecca overheard what was going on. She heard that her husband Isaac was intending on giving the blessing to Esau. Now, you're not supposed to have favorites, but apparently Isaac and Rebecca had favorites. Isaac favored Esau while Rebekah favored Jacob. So she came to her son and said, "Here's what's about to go on. Here's what you need to do. You need to go out to your flock. You need to get one of those lambs. You need to cook it in a special way that your dad likes, and I know exactly how to spice that up. And then you need to take the fleece that's on the lamb that you ended up killing and put it on your arms, because apparently Jacob was not a hairy guy, but Esau was. And so put it on your arms and put it on your neck. And among other things, when your father touches your arm or touches the back of your neck, he will feel all that hair and he will think, surely this is my son. In fact, he will pull you to himself and he will smell the field and he will think, surely this is my son Esau." And that's exactly what Jacob does. And he was obviously able to get something to eat a whole lot quicker than Esau was going out hunting. So he fixes up the stew, or the meat, or whatever it was, and comes into his father with the fleece on his arms, and the fleece on the back of his neck. And he ends up lying to his father. "Is that you, my son Esau?" "Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, that's not funny. You sound a little bit like Jacob." "Oh, no, no, it's me." So they end up having the meal. And Isaac ends up giving to Jacob the blessing. Now, we don't completely understand that altogether, I suppose, in that we end up thinking to ourselves, well, if Isaac gave the blessing to Jacob under false pretenses, surely that wouldn't count. But it did. When Esau came in and fixed up the meal and came into his father and said, okay, I'm ready to receive the blessing, Isaac was, what? What are you talking about? I already gave you the blessing. No, I just came in. Well, I gave a blessing to somebody. Well, Esau put two and two together and figured out exactly what had gone on. And Esau actually went and said, isn't there anything that you can give me? And basically Isaac says, no, I gave him all the blessings. There's nothing left for you, my son. Well, you can imagine how angry Esau must have been. In fact, Esau goes so far as to kind of whisper under his breath so that his brother Jacob could hear him, Dad's not long for this world. And whenever it is that Dad dies, you'll be joining him soon. I'll kill you. Well, apparently Esau was a formidable individual and he didn't really want to cross him. And so when Jacob ends up hearing that and Rebekah hears that, she wants to save her son, and she says, you know, maybe it's time for you to go look for a wife, my son Jacob, and you need to go. We don't want you to marry any of these women around here. These are Canaanite women. You know, they're not good enough. We want you to go back to where Abraham was from, back to the Arameans, because that's where our heritage is, and find a wife back there. And we need you, in fact, to leave really soon, son. And so Jacob basically, for all intents and purposes, has to escape Dodge because of his brother's murderous intentions. And even when Jacob returns, after over 15 years, Jacob still fears Esau. But Esau was actually now more mature and successful, and he actually went so far as to forgive his brother Jacob, who had done all these things to him. But the thing is, and this is kind of the point of the lesson, Esau's descendants weren't quite so forgiving. Edom refused, among other things, for example, to let Israel cross their land on their way to Canaan. By the time Israel was ready to come out of Egypt, Esau and his family had grown just exactly like Jacob's family had. They were an entire country all unto themselves. Edom was kind of like southeast of the Dead Sea. If you've got a map in your head, that's basically where they were located. You might recall that Israel, as they were approaching to go into Canaan, would have probably loved to have crossed over the countryside of the Edomites. And they actually asked, we promise, we're not going to drink a drop of water, we're not going to take any grass, we're not going to cost you anything, just please let us cross your country. And the Edomites said, no way, that is not happening. You cannot cross our land without us going to war over the whole business. So Israel had to kind of go way around, and it was quite some tour, I guess you could say, to get around Edom to be able to get into the land of Canaan. Now later on, even David ruled Edom. You might recall that Israel at one point did conquer Edom, made them a tributary country to them. And 2 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 14 tells us all of that, which ends up, for all intents and purposes, really kind of gaining the rightful place, the rightful rule of birthright and firstborn blessing. But after all that had happened, after all the stuff that had gone on, really, it did nothing in the world but heap up new resentments on top of old grudges. So much so that Edom hated Israel, even though they were actually brothers or cousins. And that's the rub. This is why Obadiah and the other prophets condemned Edom. They condemned Edom because of the fact that they were really brothers. Their grudges bore a very ugly fruit of gloating and looting and no compassion, whatever. Perhaps if Edom had perhaps not been related to Israel, God might have given them less harsh punishment, because, you know, he didn't particularly punish the Philistines or the Arabs. They were just doing what Gentiles do. But Edom was different. Esau was different. And as far as God is concerned, hating one's own family and doing them wrong is especially wicked in God's sight. As far as God was concerned, this was a betrayal of brotherhood, a betrayal of flesh and blood. With all of that in mind, let's read the book of Obadiah. It's not very long. I wouldn't do this unless it was short. So let's read Obadiah. The vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom. We've heard a report from the Lord, and an envoy has been sent among the nations, saying, Arise, and let us go up against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You are greatly despised. The arrogance of your heart has deceived you, you who live in the clefts of the rock and the loftiness of your dwelling place, who say in your heart, Who will bring me down to earth? Though you build high like the eagle, though you set your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. If thieves came to you, if robbers by night, oh, how you would be ruined. Would they not steal only what they until they had enough? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave some gleanings? Oh, how Esau will be ransacked and his hidden treasures searched out. All the men allied with you will send you forth to the border, and the men of peace with you will deceive you and overpower you. They who eat your bread will set an ambush for you. There's no understanding in him. Will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy wise men from Edom and understanding from the mountain of Esau? Then your mighty men will be dismayed, O Teman, so that everyone may be cut off from the mountain of Esau by slaughter. Because of the violence to your brother Jacob, you will be covered with shame, and you will be cut off forever. On the day that you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth, and foreigners entered his gate and cast lots for Jerusalem, you too were one of them. Do not gloat over your brother's day, the day of his misfortune, and do not rejoice over the sons of Judah in the day of their destruction. Yes, do not boast in the day of their distress. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their disaster. Yes, do not gloat over their calamity in the day of their disaster. Do not loot their wealth in the day of their disaster. Do not stand at the fork of the road to cut down their fugitives, and do not imprison their survivors in the day of their distress. For the day of the Lord draws near on all the nations. As you have done, it will be done to you. Your dealings will return on your own head, because just as you drank on my holy mountain, all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and swallow and become as if they had never existed. But on Mount Zion, there will be those who escape, and it will be holy. And the house of Jacob will possess their possessions. Then the house of Jacob will be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame. But the house of Esau will be as stubble, and they will set them on fire and consume them. So there will be no survivor of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. Then those of the Negev will possess the mountain of Esau, and those of the Shephelah, the Philistine plain, also possess the territory of Ephraim and the territory of Samaria, and Benjamin will possess Gilead. And the exiles of the host of the sons of Israel who are among the Canaanites as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem who are in Sepharad will possess the cities of the Negev. The deliverers will ascend Mount Zion to judge the mountain of Esau, and the kingdom will be the Lord's. So, what's going on in this prophecy? He starts off by saying or proclaiming the irresistible destruction that's going to be happening to Esau, to Edom. Edom, because of the mountainous geography, believed itself to be absolutely indomitable absolutely untouchable. They had actually carved into the mountains their cities. Many of you are familiar with this particular, if you've watched any of Indiana Jones, you recognize this. Well, it's not, it's actually in Petra, okay, which is in Jordan. It's not what Indiana Jones said it was. But this isn't the only place where they was carved into the rock, into the stone. These are all places in Edom where they actually lived in the mountain, carved their houses out of the stone. This is what made them believe that they were absolutely invulnerable. No one could conquer them because the mountainous areas they lived in, the deep ravines, who's going to come and destroy a mountain? You might destroy a wall, but can you really destroy a mountain? They thought themselves to be untouchable. But God ends up telling them, though you build high like the eagle, though you set your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. Robbers would only steal the best, he says, but you will be gleaned. And gleaning, by the way, if you're not familiar with that idea and that term, in the ancient world, when you go through a vineyard, you end up cutting, the best stuff off, but almost always you end up leaving a few grapes. Well, God had actually gone so far as to say, you only go through your vineyard one time. After that, you let other people go through because the poor need some grapes too, or they also need wheat as well. The same thing went along that line. But to glean basically means that you're leaving nothing behind. You leave the gleanings for the poor, but if the poor come through, now what's left? Nothing. He's saying, robbers would only steal the best, but you, Edom, will be gleaned. Your hidden treasures will be taken. You'll even be betrayed by close friends who will set ambushes for you. And why? Well, of course, it's very clearly because of the fact that that's what they were doing to Judah. Now, he lists specifically seven things that Edom did in Israel's misfortune, which is the reason for this destruction that is being promised here. They, in verse 12, gloated. They also rejoiced. They boasted. They entered the gate. They looted their wealth. They cut down the fugitives. They even imprisoned the survivors. There was real cruelty here among the Edomites because they had such grudges. They had such unforgiveness in their heart because they had such hatred that was there. They did all of these things to Israel. As a consequence, God was going to punish. But lastly, in this particular book, we see thirdly, as in terms of the outline, Edom will see God's people actually elevated and redeemed. Verse 18 says, in the house of Jacob will be a fire, in the house of Joseph a flame, but the house of Esau will be a stubble, and will set them on fire and consume them. So there will be no survivor of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. They will be ransacked and completely looted. On the other hand, the Lord and what will make sure that his people will be restored to all their former territory. Did you get all that as we were reading through? Talking about various parts of the nation of Israel and how they were going to be restored back to their land once again. Finally ending by saying the kingdom will be the Lord's. So what is here to learn? Well, I think there's three things especially that I think are worth our time. Number one, that human defenses are simply completely useless against the wrath and power of God. Remember as we were reading through the boast that the Edomites had? Oh, they'll never be able to take us. We live in the rocks. We live in the mountains. Who can take us? They were boasting, thinking that they were absolutely invulnerable to anyone who would come. But God is saying, you're not that indestructible. I can destroy you. And it happened just exactly as God said it would, by the way. Edom began to fall about this point, but especially after the first century AD, Edom is completely and utterly lost to history and genealogy. Nobody can even trace their genealogy back to the Edomites anymore at this point. Which all is said just to point out that God's word is sure. And God will cause it to be fulfilled in his own time. But never doubt for a moment that he will not bring every word he has spoken to fulfillment. No matter how strong we think we are, no matter how rich, no matter how powerful, no matter how good our excuses even might be, right? In God's perfect court, all human defenses will be useless against the wrath and power of God. You don't mess with God. Secondly, though, a lesson that we can get out of this is beware, you enemies of God's people. Do not gloat or abuse God's people when they are being oppressed or even punished by God. Now, I know I'm speaking to the church, but if there's those that are online who might be hearing this, it is worthwhile, and it's actually comforting to us to know that no enemy of God or God's people will be left untouched and unpunished, because God will call everyone to account. And those especially who gloat, who wag the head, who try to do everything in their power to try to persecute and oppress God's people, listen, it's going to come back on you, and you'll be punished even more than God's people were. The world always thinks it's going to win. This is a part of the deception of Satan, isn't it? This is a part of what Satan was telling Eve. You know, you can go ahead and eat of this fruit, and you will be as smart, maybe smarter than God. You know, you want to be equal with God, don't you? So go ahead and eat it. They thought after a fashion, you know, if I'm as smart as God is, if I'm as wise as he is, then, you know, what can he do to me? But she found out, of course, that God continues to be more powerful than any human being is. And this is a part of the deception that Satan continues to try to offer to humanity, that somehow or the world, it's going to win. And so it ends up mocking and wagging the head at Christians and Christianity, especially if a Christian might be caught in some sin, or perhaps they think that they have found some so-called contradiction. I'm sure we've all run into people before who thought they found some sort of a contradiction in God's word. As a preacher, I end up, you know, fielding a lot of those questions over time. And it's always kind of interesting to watch the attitude of the person who thinks they have found the contradiction in God's word. It's really kind of a gloating sort of a thing and a wagging of the head. How do you explain that one, preacher? Well, I do. And perhaps after I'm done, hopefully they're not quite as proud or arrogant as they might have been previously, I hope. But the point, very simply, is that the world always thinks it's going to win, but it doesn't. We've been studying the book of Revelation, right? Revelation chapter 11 tells about two witnesses, and all these two witnesses are such thorns in the side of the world. The world hates them until finally the witnesses are killed. And you remember what was going on when the world found out the witnesses were killed? Oh, they were rejoicing. Oh, man, this is great. They were practically dancing on their graves, except they weren't buried. They were really happy about it until the witnesses were raised. And then suddenly, they were terrified. The world in general will be in utter terror when the Lord comes back and all of God's people come to life, because they'll know that their judgment has come. But a third lesson I think it's really important for us that we can take home, especially as Christians, is that we must not gloat at the punishment or the misfortune or the oppression of others. Because hatred and grudges can do awfully ugly things to us, right? That's why, in fact, we're told that we need to forgive and not bear grudges and even love our enemies, our persecutors, our oppressors. Because here's the truth. Misfortune comes everyone's way eventually. Do you want someone to gloat over you when misfortune comes your way? Or would you not prefer compassion instead? Now, rejoicing at justice is something different. I'm not saying that we couldn't and shouldn't hope for justice. We could and should. It's a part of it's a natural part, I think, of the image of God that we have in ourselves. The thing is that we've simply been told by God that He's the one who avenges. That's not given to us. That's not anything that we can do. It's given to God alone to do. We may, on the other hand, however, be grateful when justice does happen. But even then, we need to realize that let's be honest about it, we all deserve a little justice, don't we? And would receive that justice except by God's grace and the cross of Christ. And on this last point, we must be careful to show compassion to those who are lost in sin. I've never seen anyone in this congregation ever say this, but I have seen sometimes some Christians who when they're talking to someone about the judgment and so forth, it's almost like they're almost a little on the happy side. You're going to hell. Man, we need to be careful about never doing anything like that. No wonder some in the world of the lost have no appetite for the gospel because of the attitude of some of the messengers who seem to be gloating. Compassion is so important in both the physical and the spiritual world. Compassion for the sin-ravaged, guilt-burdened, and world-weary lost is in order for all of us to have into our hearts. So when we contact our lost friends, those who have never been baptized into Christ, or those who have fallen away, about coming to our meeting with Jack Evans, then let it be with genuine compassion and concern because of the grace of God that was shown towards us and the grace of God that we want to be shown toward them. Don't be found in the shoes of the Edomites who gloated over their brother's misfortune, because just like the Edomites who foolishly thought they were untouchable, there is no excuse that will stand before the justice and judgment of God. But here's good news. God's grace in Jesus' blood is always available. This evening, if in thinking about some of these things from the book of Obadiah, you know that there are areas in your life that you do need to change, you do need to fix, as it were. We encourage you to no longer put it off, but instead to come to the Lord with your sin-burdened heart and receive the forgiveness that Jesus alone can offer because of the blood that He shed. This evening, if it happens to be that you are not yet a Christian, according to the New Testament pattern, or if you are a Christian and need to come back to the Lord, we encourage you, please, respond by coming forward while we stand and sing this.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is His new creation by water and the word. From Him He came and saw.